The Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, aka the DSM, is the book that just keeps on giving. The DSM-1 published in 1952 and listed 106 disorders, but by 1980 the third version contained 265 disorders, and number 4 listed 297. 2013's version of this psychiatrist's bible lists 300 maladies according to Reuters, all contained in 947 pages. You can find within those hallowed sheets things such as intermittent explosive disorder and the male crisis of delayed ejaculation. Some critics argue that some of the disorders are farcical, turning normal human behavior into a disease. Others say the pharmaceutical industry profiteers from the growing number of mental problems. Still, there can be no doubt some of us were endowed with or picked up some unusual mental conditions. Today, we'll try our best to explain just one disorder in this episode of the Infographics Show. What actually is bipolar disorder? First of all, let's address the criticisms of the growing number of mental disorders. We should remember that in our darker past, we didn't really know what was wrong with some people when they were perhaps acting differently from what we might consider normal folks. Often, we just locked them away in dank cells. We might have bled them to purge them of the malady, or years later given them lobotomies. In part of the world today, you might still find communities locking up their mentally ill, fearing they have been cursed, sometimes sacrificing chickens as appropriation to the spirit so they'll show some mercy and release the mentally ill person from the hex. We've come a long way, both in how we treat patients and how our society empathizes with such people. There's a good argument, however, that drugs might be overprescribed, that perhaps not so many young teens need to be pilled up on legal amphetamines to get them through the day, or that Xanax or Valium are perhaps not always the panacea for one's anxieties. It's said that almost 44 million Americans suffer from a mental disorder, which is about 1 in 5 people. The National Alliance of Mental Illness tells us that 1 in 5 people in the US aged just 13 to 18 will suffer from a severe mental illness. On a global scale, we're told by some sources that 1.1 billion people suffer from some kind of mental disorder. The World Health Organization said in 2018 that 300 million of those people are down with depression, 50 million have dementia, 23 million have some kind of psychosis, and 60 million have bipolar disorder. In that article, it didn't mention general anxiety disorder, but it said it's the most common disorder around the world. That might not mean massive, utterly debilitating panic attacks, but just anxiety that makes life difficult at times. After all, we all get anxious from time to time. It's a natural chemical response that helps us to survive. It's just some people have a bit too much anxiety. There's no way to get an accurate number of anxiety sufferers in the world, as much of the world might not even have a concept of it as a disorder, and many other sufferers won't have seen a doctor. Try telling a tribesman in the far reaches of Southeast Asia that their son has anxiety and his borderline ADHD requires a dose of Ritalin, and see where you get. Nonetheless, there are numbers out there, and some say around the world 1 in 13 people suffer from chronic anxiety. But let's focus on America, where it seems mental disorders grow like weeds on an abandoned parking lot. According to our data, about 1 in 5 people in the USA will suffer from a diagnosable mental disorder. We suppose that means quite a lot of our viewers, so we look forward to your comments after the show. Coming in at the number 1 slot, as we said, is anxiety. That accounts for 19.1% of adults, and it means anxiety that negatively affects day-to-day life, work, school, buying a pair of shoes in a bright shopping mall, etc. Number 2 was the black dog, aka depression, and that affected 6.7 million Americans when the study was published in 2016. But number 3, a disorder we might say has shot up the charts relatively recently, was bipolar disorder. This affects about 4.4% of the American public. Next was post-traumatic stress disorder at 3.6%, and way behind in terms of numbers was schizophrenia. As for the disorder that affects mainly American kids, the controversial attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, well, the CDC says that the malady affects around 6.4 million Americans aged 4 to 17. That's right, 6.1% of youngsters. We should add that over the last 8 years, it's gone up 41%. Right now, between the scientific community, there's a schism wherein many people say it doesn't even exist or shouldn't be seen as a disorder, and others say it does and definitely is. But we won't get into that today. So, bipolar disorder. America's mental enemy number 3. What is it? Well, you see, it used to be called something different, and that was manic depression. Many of you who have experienced general depression, unipolar disorder, know it's kind of like having a black cloud following you around, and often you just don't know why it's there or how to get rid of it. Sometimes it's accompanied with feelings of doom, an ever-present black dog that keeps following you around and not allowing you to have fun, relax, let loose, enjoy the world around you. It feels like every thought you have is contaminated, like your very blood is soiled. This can last a long time, and sometimes you might not even know just how depressed you've been until you've come out of it. Bipolar disorder is different, but often confused with depression. Psychology Today describes bipolar disorder as being a chronically recurring condition involving moods that swing between the highs of mania and the lows of depression. But manic is the word we should think about, because bipolar may come with these bouts of feeling enervated, downcast, a feeling of ennui that won't let you get out of bed, and then there's the other pole. That pole a few of you will certainly know means a sudden feeling of great energy, excitement, sometimes a rush of euphoria. Your mind races, sometimes you can't shut up, but you might also feel irritable and angry. We're also told that some people might go as far as to go on massive spending sprees or even engage in binges of copulation with strangers. As you can guess, moving between these vastly different poles is the cause of great and sometimes debilitating instability. If you've had friends with bipolar disorder, you'll know that one day they might be calling you, making plans to do amazing things, or at least just touch base more, and then you don't hear from them for a while and they don't pick up the phone. It's quite hard to diagnose, of course, because many people just go through changing moods. They're moody. Others are hyperactive sometimes, but it's not always a bad thing. They're just full of energy, but like most things in this world, that energy has to dissipate. You're generally diagnosed with bipolar disorder when your symptoms are extreme, so don't you guys worry if you're prone to great excitement and making plans and then sometimes go in reverse. Close the blinds and hide from the world. That's not always abnormal. We checked out a few psych sites to see exactly what the symptoms of bipolar disorder are. Of course, some of the things we've talked about are included, but you must know that they have to be in the extreme. We're talking about tectonic mood shifts, a polarization that has a negative effect on you and those around you. You might sleep too much, hardly sleep at all, and that can make you irritable throughout the day. What we sometimes call wired. During the hypermanic stage, your thoughts might race, kind of like a person high on cocaine. You have fancy ideas, sometimes you feel grandiose, you're at the top of your game, you're not actually. Sometimes reckless, you think you're heading in the right place even if you're being intrusive, annoying, or aggressive. You might also chat more, but that might even come out as babble, as you can be easily distracted and your friends might think your ideas are absurd. This period will stop and you'll come crashing down like a grand piano falling from the 13th floor. Your great thoughts and ideas and excitement now shattered and splintered in the street below. This is usually followed by darkness, depression, lassitude, remoteness, and inability to communicate. The battery is dead. It might mean that you can't get out of bed, you might put on weight, you have no energy, you feel hopeless, empty, can't concentrate, and sometimes think a lot about self-harm or ending it all. Some people do, however, have a kind of manic episode that's not followed by this awful pall. They have the hypomania, but don't get the deep depression. Others will have those bouts of hypomania, but they'll be short-lived, while the depression part is very long. We know of one such case of a man whose hypomania would last perhaps a day or two, but for months, this unfortunate person disappeared under a large blanket of insuperable depression. These people might not experience worrying effects during the hyper stage, but the depression is not an easy thing to live with. Then there are people who are up and down very often, hyper and depressed, perhaps in the same day. They swing from one pole to another, but those poles at least are not as extreme as those people who deal with them for longer periods of time. Sure, it can still be debilitating having moods that shift like the wind, but it's perhaps less severe than those who experience extreme ups and downs. There is help for you if you think you've suffered from bipolar disorder, and that doesn't mean you have to start taking meds all the time. There are mood stabilizers you can take, but you can also just talk about your problems in therapy. Just go and see a doctor and you'll get help. Why bipolar disorder happens varies from person to person. It might just be passed on, something in your bloodline. At the moment, experts tell us that there's no specific gene related to bipolar disorder, but they say that certain factors, including age of your parents, might result in you having this disorder. Scientists have looked at what happens in the brain of sufferers, including during manic and down periods, and indeed they saw irregularities, but it still remains something of a mystery. We're told in the future there might be certain biomarkers for bipolar disorder, but as yet nothing is written in stone, or should we say inscribed in the brain. But there might also be environmental factors, meaning you picked it up because of things that were happening around you. The good news is, what can be created can be deleted. Childhood trauma might have helped cause it, and it might reappear during particularly stressful times in your life. Don't despair. You've heard people talking about your brain's plasticity, which basically means you can overcome your disorders, weaknesses, through making changes, having different habits, learning about your disorder, and understanding it better. We are all works in progress, and we're able to edit the present and write the future. Have you suffered from this disorder? Because we'd love to know how you felt and how you dealt with it. Same goes for anyone diagnosed with bipolar disorder now. Let's hear your story and get some advice for those who might need it. Tell us in the comments. Also, be sure to check out our other show, Everything You Know About Sleep Is Wrong. Thanks for watching, and as always, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. See you next time.